Welcome to another episode of the Tales of Rhine City podcast. This is Tier.
And Michael.
And today's episode is mostly going to be presented to you by Michael because it is a focus solely on Jack and Jack's crew of debauchery. So if he needs me, I'll pop in and chat, but otherwise it's pretty much all him.
Oh god, where do you even begin here? So, Jack Fairchild, aka Jack the Ripper, was not always intended to be the main villain of the story, and he didn't even really exist in the planning phase. I know I've mentioned this before, but even in the RP, a lot of what makes Jack Jack was part of Rex. Rex was a villain. Rex initially started out as a villainous OC for a superhero story I had. He was called Suicide King, and basically he would kill himself and explode and then come back, you know. And he was, he had a half-sister named Rose, and he was, uncomfortably fixated on her, let's say. And he was just a bloodthirsty psychopath who liked to kill people, make them suffer, and was just kind of like, you know, he reveled in being an asshole. Now, Rex isn't like that anymore. But Jack got all of those negative qualities. And he came about because ever since I was a kid, I have been absolutely fascinated by the Jack the Ripper case. I just think it's such an interesting unsolved mystery. I was true crime before true crime was a thing. None of these white girls with their podcasts got anything on me. I was reading Jack the Ripper when I was in first grade. I was absorbing all of that horrific serial killer knowledge. Don't go on the Wikipedia page. They have pictures of his victims. I don't know if they have the other ones. I know they have the really bad one. It's kind of amazing that they have like a photograph from over 100 years ago. Isn't that wild? Getting a little off topic. Anyway, I'd always wanted to like use Jack the Ripper in a story. In other stories I've like conceptualized and imagined and tried writing, I have used Jack the Ripper as a character. In fact, it's a little embarrassing. I used him in a creative writing thing I did in high school. I had to write a short story for a class, and I used Jack the Ripper in it. So, I've always wanted to use Jack the Ripper in something. And so, when Rex became more of a nice guy, and we decided he was going to be part of this four-way romance with him, JoJo, Gabby, and Flynn, we needed somewhere for all the bad stuff to go. And so, I was like, hey, what about Jack the Ripper? Because I had actually, in the planning, I had said, oh, Rex was Jack the Ripper, there we go, and he was that in the RP too, so I was like, hey, what if I just cut that out, take all the bad stuff from Rex, and there's Jack the Ripper, and thus Jack was born. In the original draft of the book, he actually did not appear until well over halfway through the draft, so he wasn't quite built up as well. And there was the allusions to him torturing and assaulting JoJo, but it's like, there is so much less build-up to what he was like and what he does than even in this draft. And this draft is still going to get polished even more for the third draft. And it will be more build-up, more, you know, more of all that. But he didn't appear until, like, halfway through, maybe more than halfway through. And that's kind of the case here, too. He's appearing, like, two-thirds of the way into this draft. But we're trying to build him up more, so it's more like when he shows up, it's like a sign shit is getting serious instead of just, oh, hey, look, this book needs an antagonist now. The interesting thing is, as we've written this draft, and he's become just more and more of a horrible, unpleasant person who revels in being a horrible, unpleasant person, a lot of the characters around him have become nicer to the point where they're not even really villains anymore, so much as people who constantly make stupid decisions or just can't handle things. They can't deal with things around them because it's beyond their control. Like, initially, Amon was going to be the final boss of the first trilogy. He was going to be the overarching villain, quote-unquote. He was going to be more of an anti-villain, but he was still going to do something really stupid. But he's basically become the big good of this trilogy. And Eve was a lot worse initially. Even in this draft, in the early chapters, you can see that she's just kind of an asshole. But as Jack and his role in the story kind of grew as we wrote, Eve has become more and more sympathetic to the point where it's like everything in her life just seems to be out of her control and she's being manipulated. So that's going to be a lot more clear in the third draft when we polish up the first few chapters so, you know, it flows together a little better. But yeah, so Jack is basically this big evil sponge. He just sponges the evil from other people and becomes worse with every passing moment. So let's see, a little bit about him since, or like where I got elements of him from. So I've always imagined him, one of the big inspirations, and this is who I used as a face claim when I commissioned art, is Alex DeLarge from A Clockwork Orange, which is, you know, I feel like that's a pretty obvious inspiration. He's like, because Alex is a criminal, he does what he wants because he can. He is a rapist, a murderer, and he's also a very handsome man. He's pretty, he dresses up, he hangs out with his buddies, he goes to bars, he's just a... Oh, and he really loves music. I think that's always a good sign of a really great villain, is one who just has this one specific music artist or something that they really fixate on. Like with Alex DeLarge, it was Beethoven. He really loved Beethoven. And with Jack, it is ABBA. And the reason for that is ABBA is one of my favorite bands of all time. And I just thought it would be funny if I gave the main villain of the first trilogy one of my favorite bands of all time as their favorite band. It's just like a funny little thing, you know. I'm not above poking fun at myself or giving the villain things, interests that I like, you know, that sort of thing. I guess another one, a little less, it would be Patrick Bateman. I actually do have a couple of scenes where he goes on like a Patrick Bateman monologue, like his introduction into the book, which is not edited or published yet. We're getting close to it. He basically goes on a Patrick Bateman-esque monologue about ABBA, of course. And he kind of does that a lot because... And here's another major inspiration. He kind of has a kind of a god complex. He rejected his humanity to become this powerful vampire. He loves throwing knives. He's just... like, completely bonkers, because I drew a lot of inspiration from Dio Brando from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, which, funnily enough, also has Jack the Ripper as a vampire, but that was not intentional. I literally forgot Jack the Ripper was in JoJo's Bizarre Adventure because he's just, like, such a minor fucking character. And he, like, dies after, like, 2 minutes. Like, they take one of... history's most famous unsolved murderers, and they turn him into a vampire, and then they have him killed as a warm up so that our JoJo can practice his Hamon abilities. I think that's kind of lame, but then, you know, I don't really like Phantom Blood as much as the other parts, but Dio is still a great inspiration. Yeah, Jack is definitely... he's basically what happens if you crossed Dio with Alex DeLarge. Even going further, he has, like, this whole crew of people he has pulled in, some less willingly than others. So, yeah, Jack is basically Dio if he were Jack the Ripper. I will give you all a sneak peek. I am going to tell you the backstory of Jack... lay it out to you, detail it, because this is probably going to come up in book 2, but you're already listening to this podcast, I'd like to reward the viewers with a little bit of juicy information. So, here is basically what I have planned for his backstory, and this will be revealed as the story goes on. Jack was the son of a prostitute named Charlotte and a surgeon who visited her often, get his rocks off, named Arthur Fairchild. And Jack, he grew up mostly in poverty with his mother. His mother did her best to take care of him, raise him through at least a little bit of his childhood. She instilled in him a love of chess. That was her one thing that she loved. She loved chess, and she taught him how to play. She was, by all accounts, a good mother, though she might have been a little too good, and instilled in Jack his weird, Oedipus complex kind of thing. One day, though, the 19th century, she got sick and died, and Jack was trapped with her for a few days. He was trapped with a dead body. He didn't really know what to do. He watched the rats eat at her. Eventually, his father came back and found her and found him. And, he decided he would actually step up and be a good dad, which, would eventually not lead to anything good. So he took in Jack. He taught him all sorts of surgical skills. Raised him, but he was definitely more like a distant dad. Like, he raised him and was nice enough in private, but in public he kind of just treated him like a protege, this is my student. Not really like a dad in public, because he doesn't want his high society friends knowing, oh, you had a kid with a prostitute. So and Jack has this building resentment and anger and whatever over the years, and eventually, this leads to an altercation where he stabs his father to death, and that was his first victim. From there, he, freaks out and flees, and I'm not going to get too much into this, but he meets someone who offers to help him get away, get a fresh start. He accepts, and from there, this is when he goes to the school, Dracula's school, since now he's... This person was in the supernatural world, so this is how Jack got pulled into the supernatural world. He goes to school, that's where he meets Rose, and, begins dating her. He's pretty hostile to anyone who's not nice to Rose, and that's just about a lot of people. A lot of people bullied Rose in school. He especially hated Mariana. He hated her from pretty much the moment he saw her, because she came from this rich, privileged background, and now she was in a relationship with Dracula's adopted daughter, and she was Eve's adopted daughter, and basically just had the world handed to her on a silver platter, while he had to struggle, and he had to claw his way up to get anything. Basically, he just resented her because she had a better life than he did, which, is kind of like Dio and how he treated Jonathan, more of that little JoJo in the bloodline. So, I just realized it's funny. He's based on Dio, and he like spent so much time abusing a guy named JoJo. So, this eventually comes to a head when he pulls off. He basically outs Mariana to the school and outs her in a very awkward and embarrassing situation that leaves Mariana very ashamed and uncomfortable. And it's at this point where Rose kind of has to step back, and she looks at him, and she's like, "Oh my God, why are you doing this? This isn't what I wanted at all." And eventually, this does lead to her looking deeper into him and finding out, yes, he stabbed his father to death, and basically she freaks out, and Jack gets upset, and he leaves the school, and I'm going to gloss over this because this is also, you know, a little too much. Don't want to give the whole hand away. But he meets someone else who offers him a perfect opportunity to get revenge. And Jack goes back to the first person, who I glossed over, and he gets set up with a bunch of special abilities. He becomes a vampire. He heads on back to the school, and he essentially does a school shooting, but with knives. He just kills his way through Dracula's school, and he does this because he wants to, you know, like, get rid of all the people who abused Rose, and then they can be together, and obviously she doesn't like that, because she's not a psychopathic asshole. So she rejects him. Jack goes ballistic and chases her down. Mariana helps save her. Rex was in a polycule back then. His two partners help Mariana escape. They get killed. A lot of people get killed. Eventually, there is an intervention, and Rose and Mariana are saved. Dracula, Mon, and Rex kick Jack's ass, and he flees. Eve promises to hunt him down and make him pay for what he did. And, well, things just got worse from there because, you know, when Eve found Jack, she came back with him. She had a change of tune, and that's when Dracula decided, nope, you know what, she's too far gone. Time to kill her. And then, you know, that led into all the nonsense that led up to the book today. That's essentially Jack's early life. And this will be, you know, fleshed out and expanded upon. There's some stuff I want to polish out. But, yeah, that's the general basic gist of Jack's backstory. We did touch upon Jack's coven, the Killer Elite, in a previous video. A lot of them. So, like I was saying, you know, Jack was inspired by Dio, and this is basically Dio's stand users, but, you know, they're vampires. And much like that, some of them are just willing to work with him because, you know, he's powerful. He's offering them stuff they could never get. Others were coerced. For example, Cyrus Lovelace, the Confederate vampire who has been on the run for a long, long time, he's with Jack because, you know, it's safety. No one's going to kill him because no one can mess with Jack. Cyrus is a coward. He's not a good fighter. He basically relies on, you know, anyone else to deal with stuff for him. He only uses his power as a last resort. It's a very strong power, but, you know, he's a coward. So, you know, Jack takes care of him, lets him do his little racist business as long as he answers to Jack. Then there are vampires like Weston or even Ava Otto. They are vampires who Jack has coerced into working with him for some reason or another, one way or another. They don't necessarily like Jack or want to really work for him, but, you know, they don't have any choice. Jack has some sort of leverage on them. With Weston, it's because Jack has his contract that he signed with the devil, so, you know, Jack is basically the owner of him now. Or with Ava, I will reveal that in book 2 when she gets more developed as a character, but Jack has leverage on her. So, you know, most of the people in the coven, even his own friend group, quote unquote, can't stand him. Everyone hates him because he goes out of his way to just, he thinks he can do anything to anyone without any consequence, because technically he can't face any consequence. He can't be killed for a reason which will be revealed by the end of this book, first book. He can't be killed by any of these people, and there's only one specific circumstance in which he is capable of dying, and no one's really figured it out yet. No one can seem to figure it out. And so this actually means he is technically immune to Silver. Silver cannot kill him. It should be able to kill him, but it can't, because that's not... That's just not how he's supposed to die. So, no one can stand him, because he can basically do whatever the hell he wants and face no consequences, because no matter what they do to him, he's always just going to come back. Hopefully that will change by the end of this trilogy, but, you know, not gonna spoil that all in one sitting. You're just going to have to wait and find out if they manage to stop him. I mean, they probably will. I mean, we got a bunch of stories after that, so, you know, can't have Jack running around in all of them. Real quick before we wrap this up, I will talk about his power, because I haven't really touched on that yet. Much like a lot of characters, his powers went through a lot of iterations, obviously. It started out, you know, as Rex's power. You know, he kills himself, the corpse explodes, but he's okay, he comes up from somewhere else. Obviously, that changed when I separated him from Rex, and it became like, you know... It became like he could travel through shadows, like, ooh, he's like, he slides in the shadows, he slides out, he's a sneaky little bastard. Eventually, when working on this second draft, I realized he should just be able to do that. He should just be able to have magic that he can do that. That shouldn't be his power. And, again, drawing inspiration from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, and specifically Dio, his power became, you know, he can make knives. He can make a bunch of knives, he can throw the knives... And, you know, since he has a background in surgery, he has very surgical precision if he's wielding the knife, and he is actually very good at throwing knives as well. And I feel like that's a lot better and more in-character power for him to have. I think he should just be able to travel through shadows as, like, you know, just a thing he can do. Like, he can do some magic. The knife thing, that needs to be his thing. And, well, really, that's about all I got to say about Jack. He's a pretty important character, the main villain of this first trilogy, or like one of the main villains. We'll see some other ones in book 3, but they'll be villains for something else. Jack's really the big bad of this. He's kind of the problem that our heroes have to go through and beat. And yeah, that's about it for him.
Alright, that is the end of our episode for today. If you enjoyed this, make sure to hit that thumbs up button. If you want to see more from us, make sure to subscribe. If you haven't read the Tales of Rhine City book, you want to check it out, I will go ahead and post the link to the list of chapters. If you click on each chapter, it'll actually take you right to where we have the chapter posted. The website format that we are using to post it isn't really the greatest, but it works for now as we are continuing to edit and rework the book. So, if you just go by the link of chapters, like, that's really the best way. All right, we will hopefully see you guys next week. If you have any suggestions for an upcoming episode, something you want to hear us talk about that we haven't already, make sure to suggest it. Our main focus is really the Vampire Trilogy, as that's the one that is the most fleshed out as of right now. But if you want to hear about any of the other trilogies, we can talk about what we have planned thus far. And with that, I will go ahead and wrap this video up. See you, everybody.
Did you like this video? Hit the like button and subscribe for more content. If you really liked it, consider sending me a tip on Venmo. My information is down in the description below. I hope to see you again soon.